My name is Jerry Franklin, and I'm a retired professor emeritus at the University of Washington and a previous employee of the United States Forest Service as an ecologist. Well, let me start out by saying when I started in forestry 60 plus years ago, foresters' perspective on a forest was it was a collection of trees. That's all it was. And what you did with it was you managed it to produce wood. And that's what a forest was. And I'm sure that, you know, in those days, they realized there was more to it than simply some trees, a collection of trees. And they realized that the forest was doing more than just producing wood. But that was really all they knew about it at that point. And so a forester's mission was to manage the collection of trees, to efficiently produce wood, because the country needed wood. They needed a lot of wood. And that limited view of forests has changed completely during the last 60 years. And so whereas a forester in the old days might have said, you know there's more out here than just trees, they didn't know what it was. But today we know what it is. And what we've done over the last 60 years is a lot of research, looking at forests as ecosystems rather than simply as collection of trees to be managed for wood production. And it's just been amazing to realize how far we've come in looking at a place like this and seeing how complex it is in terms of it's got such a rich biota. You know, it's not just about trees, it's about all kinds of other organisms, mammals, birds, amphibians, reptiles, fungi, mosses. You know, it's a very complex interacting system. We as human beings look for forests to do a tremendous array of things for us. We expect it to protect our watersheds, to produce a condition so we get well-regulated flows of high-quality water and don't get a lot of bad floods. We look to the forest to not only produce wood, but to sequester carbon and to interact in other ways with climate. We look to the forest to obviously provide habitat for a tremendous array of other organisms. And of course, we look to it for recreation and inspiration as well. And one of the things in learning about the forest as an ecosystem was the realization that one of the reasons a natural forest ecosystem can do this is because it doesn't try to maximize any single output. So this forest is not trying to be real efficient at wood production, for example, but in fact is carrying on all of these activities simultaneously, and none is sort of being maximized. And what we did as foresters was always to try to maximize that production function of providing wood. And whenever you do that, you tend to ignore the other values that are out here in the forest. And certainly when we emphasized wood production, we did it at the expense of all the other elements of the forest and all of the other functions of the forest. And so what we're trying to do with restoration and what we're trying to do with ecological forestry, and restoration is one element of ecological forestry, ecological forestry encompasses it, is to take forests that have been dramatically altered by fire suppression on the east side, by harvesting, clear cutting on the west side, and we try to begin to manage it in ways that begins to restore the completeness, the wholeness. And we often talk in ecosystem management of trying to restore the integrity. and then manage that forest so that we continue to sustain the integrity of the completeness of that system. It doesn't mean you leave it alone. It simply means you recognize all of the elements of it and all of the values that are here and take that into consideration. And a general principle of ecological management is you don't ever try to maximize anything. Anytime you do that, you're going to begin to marginalize other values. And so restoration is an aspect of ecological forestry where you're trying to take a damaged system and move it back to wholeness, to completeness, to functionality. The industrial forest managers, they're focused on maximizing wood production in the short term in order to provide a high return on capital. That's all they care about. And so that's where they focus, and they simplify the forest. And in fact, the plantations that industry does are not forests. They are farms. And they used to call them tree farms. They don't like that now because it makes it very clear what they are, which is these are not forest systems. They're not complete. These are simply farms where we're growing wood in order to get some return on capital. And in ecological forestry, in contrast to that, we definitely are managing the forest so that in fact we're going to sustain all of the elements. And if you look around this forest, you can see the richness and complexity. In the first place, it's not one species. There's at least six tree species here within reaching distance of us. And it's not just live trees. And you look around and my goodness sakes, there's all kinds of logs and dead wood lying on the ground. And there's a great big snag right there, big dead tree. Now this is, you know, for an industrial forester, this is horrible. A tree has died. But in fact, from the standpoint of the ecosystem, the dead tree is as important as the live tree is. And so we have to restore some of that richness, structural richness to the system. And another thing we notice about it is, what? The trees aren't in rows. They're highly dispersed through here in a very random almost pattern. In fact, it's a very systematic pattern once you understand and look at it mathematically. That's a very patchy forest. It's very what we call heterogeneous, non-uniform. But of course, in our plantations, in the tree farms, we're trying to be very efficient in growing wood, and you put them in rows and you just make sure that they're spaced out very evenly. Nature doesn't do that. Now, how do we manage this in a way that sustains that completeness, maintains its integrity, but still takes some value out of it in the form of harvesting trees? And one of the keys, of course, is that you have to grow forests for longer periods of time if you want to get these kinds of forest conditions. And one of the things that you do when you come in here and harvest, of course, this is a park, so we're not going to harvest here, but if we were, we would never clear cut. We would do some kind of a partial cut where we would leave some of the forest behind to provide continuity, to provide a continuance of structure, function, composition through each generation. So the industrial model was clear cut it, remove everything, start over again. The ecological forestry approach to it is, no, you don't do that. What you do is you go in and you remove some, but you leave a lot of structure, a lot of trees, dead wood, etc., behind, because that next generation of forest needs that continuity from the previous generation. And nature, we learned this at Mount St. Helens. It was just marvelous. We thought, you know, oh, disaster, complete disaster, moonscape. We have to start over again. And in fact, the matter, nature had left behind incredible legacies of living organisms, including live trees. It had left behind a tremendous legacy of dead material, logs on the forest floor, standing dead trees, and organisms. And so Mount St. Helens was a wonderful example to us of how extreme a disturbance could be, and yet nature provides for that continuity. Certification is a very important concept. And, you know, it's important the consumer be able to have some way of knowing that the products that they're buying are done in environmentally and socially responsible ways. But the problems, we have two forms of certification right now. One of them, which is a sustainable forestry initiative, is essentially meaningless from an ecological perspective. It is simply a certification process that says, oh yeah, I'm gonna plant trees back after I cut my trees, and I'm gonna try to avoid doing damage. But it's really was designed by the industry people themselves as a way of making themselves look greener. The other one, of course, is forest FSC certification, and it's very meaningful, but it's a very expensive kind of certification to do. And so many small forest landowners can't afford to get certified by FSC. Many community forests can't afford that kind of thing. The certification systems we've got now aren't doing all they should. Some of the most ecologically responsible wood that's being produced today is being produced by landowners and land managers who are doing the right thing, either for one reason or another don't or can't get certified. How can we recognize these people that are doing beyond forestry? They're doing really ecologically based forestry, but they're not certified. How can we recognize these people in a simple way that doesn't cost them a whole lot of money? There are ways that we could do this, and one of the ways that you can recognize truly ecologically sustainable forestry is people are going to be using longer rotations. They're not going to be cutting their forests at 35 and 40 years. They're going to be growing their forests for 70, 80, 90, 100, 100 plus years, particularly here in the Douglas fir region, because that's the only way that you get really whole ecosystems. And it's also the only way you really realize the potential of Douglas fir here on the west side, which is a species, it's not a sprinter. It's a long distance runner. And to get its full growth potential, you really have to grow the forest for at least a century. Or 80 years, let's say, 70 or 80 years. And when you cut it at 35 or 40 years, it's only barely started its growth. And so to realize the productive potential in the Douglas fir forest region and of the Douglas fir tree, you can recognize an ecologically based management scheme based simply on rotation. How long are you growing your forest before you cut it? And then the second thing is, when you cut it, do you leave legacies behind? Do you leave some of the trees behind? Do you leave some dead wood behind? Or do you just slick it off? And the third way is, and after you cut it, do you spray it with herbicides? And an ecological forester is not going to be using very much in the way of herbicides at all. They just won't do it. They don't need to do it. What I think we need to be doing is looking for credible organizations like that to identify those people and, in fact, perhaps ultimately provide them with some kind of a certification. But it is a real problem. It's a real challenge to find sustainable wood today, and you have to make an effort to do it. One of the problems, particularly, not exclusively, but particularly on the public lands, there's been a tremendous amount of controversy in the last 50 years. And a lot of it's been over the fact that we were cutting virgin forests. Essentially, we were cutting down old growth forests, and ultimately that's what a lot of the battles became. And they developed a high level of distrust with public forestry agencies in particular, state and federal. And the collaboratives have become a powerful tool for people coming together, sharing their views, coming up with win-win kinds of solutions for some of these issues, and rebuilding the trust in terms of management of forests. You know, the natural tendency of people when they think things are going wrong in the woods is say, stop, don't do anything. And don't go into those over dense forests with too much fuel in them. You know, I don't believe you. You're just doing it because you want wood. And collaboratives are just so powerful in resolving many of the conflicts and providing, you know, a public endorsement of activity which is doing good, which is essential kinds of activities. And it couldn't be more important than it is now, because with climate change, the forests are going to need our participation. We need to be collaborating with the forests to help sustain them. I mean, we've changed them, we've changed the environment they're in, and we can't leave it to nature to try to restore a balance. We've changed everything, and we know enough that we can be powerful participants with the forests in sustaining them. And so it's just critical that we do so. Walking away from the forests that we've changed through our management activities, through past harvesting, through fire suppression, walking away from them at this point in time when we've altered the basic environment in which they're going, is not rational. Mr. Spock would say this is not rational, and it isn't. We know a great deal. We know how to work with forests today to restore them. And we need to have the social license to do that.